So we've been looking at period doubling, and here's again this picture. We have period doubling from 2 to 4, 4 to 8, and so on. Capital delta is the range of parameter values for which we have period 2. Delta 2 is the next range. Delta 3 is the next range. And we define these ratios, this divided by this, this divided by that, to be these little deltas. And for the logistic equation, we found that delta 1 is about 4.75, and delta 2 is about 4.65, 4.66. In the quiz that you just did, you did the same thing for the cubic equation, and you found 4.419 and 4.618. So the numbers for delta 1 and delta 2 for these two equations aren't similar. Are similar, but not identical. However, if we kept going on and calculated delta 3 and delta 4 and delta 5 and so on, these numbers would get closer and closer to each other. So let me write that. We're interested in delta n, which is capital delta n over capital delta n plus 1. And this is going to go to the number 4.669201. So for both of these equations, as we let n get larger and larger, we get closer and closer to this transition point. These ratios approach 4.669201. So in the large n limit, this number is just known as delta, and we would say that delta is universal. So delta is universal. And what that means is that it has the same value for a very large class or family of functions. Let me state this a little bit more carefully, since it's a crucial result. So again, the phenomenon of universality. We have delta n approaching a number delta. And we say that delta is universal. And the result is that this number delta is the same, 4.669201, for all iterated functions that map an interval to itself and have a single quadratic maximum. So let me say a little bit about these conditions. So if the function maps an interval to itself, that just excludes the possibility that orbits go off to infinity, positive or negative infinity. So the logistic equation is an example. It mapped the unit interval to itself, meaning numbers between 0 and 1 remain between 0 and 1. Let me draw some pictures to illustrate this. What does it mean for a function to have a single quadratic maximum? Let's see. So, single quadratic maximum. So, our favorite example, the logistic equation. That's just an upside-down parabola. It has a single maximum right here, and it's quadratic because, well, it's a parabola. It's a quadratic function. Here's another example, though. This is, let's see. The cubic function looks something like this. It's not symmetric, and the function is not exactly a parabola. However, if we look closely near the maximum, it would become more and more parabola-like. So it's locally parabolic. And in calculus terms, this just means that the second derivative doesn't disappear. So most functions that have a peak like this will behave this way. Let me give some counterexamples. This function does not have a single quadratic maximum because it does not have a single maximum. It has two. The local max here and then there. So this function does not meet the criteria in that statement that I gave on the previous piece of paper. A few more counterexamples. Maybe a function like this. This has a single maximum, a nice peak, but it's not a quadratic maximum. If you zoom in on this point, it doesn't start to look like a parabola. It keeps looking like a point. The idea is this is infinitely sharp. Here, if you zoom in on this, you can make it look as much as a make it look as close to a parabola as you wish. So this is not does not have a single quadratic maximum because it has a maximum, but it's not quadratic. It's pointy. Here's one more example. Has a maximum, but it's flat. So it doesn't really have a single maximum value. And if you zoom in on this line, again, it won't look like a parabola. It will look like a line. So this is also not a function with a single quadratic maximum. So any function with a single quadratic maximum could be a parabola, a cubic function, sine functions, various exponentials. There are many, many, many examples of such functions. And this is a pretty generic criteria, in that if you just draw a function by hand or cook something up that has a single maximum, it'll odds are it'll be smooth, and this criteria will hold. So this isn't a very restrictive criteria, and there's a vast number of functions that meet this criteria. So let me state this once more. This property delta, which is a feature of how the sideways use those shapes on the bifurcation diagram, how they're related to each other, how much smaller each one gets as we get closer to this transition, that this geometric quantity delta is universal. It has the same value, 4.669201, and it goes on for all iterated functions f of x that map an interval to itself and have a single quadratic maximum. So again, this is not a very restrictive criteria. So any function you come up with that meets this very mild criteria, you can make a bifurcation diagram, find the bifurcation points like we did, calculate the deltas, go deeper and deeper, let n get larger and larger, and this number will appear. So this number is a property of all of those functions. So I want to emphasize just how amazing this result is. We started with the logistic equation, just about as simple a nonlinear equation as one could imagine, and we saw that we had this bifurcation diagram with an amazing amount of complexity, but also with some regularity. We saw those pitchforks, those sideways U's repeating again and again and again, and we noticed that there's sort of a geometric similarity to them, that the next pitchfork in the sequence is smaller than the previous one, but maybe smaller by the same factor. So that led us to investigate that idea quantitatively, and we define these lowercase deltas as that ratio of one pitchfork length to the next pitchfork length. And we found that that ratio approaches a constant number, this number 4.669. And that's an interesting result for the logistic equation. It's a perhaps a little mathematical oddity, tells us about the geometry of this particular bifurcation diagram. Then we looked at bifurcation diagrams for other equations, quite different equations, sines and cubes as well as parabolas, and we saw the same general features of the bifurcation diagram. But then if we calculate these deltas, and we kept calculating them to larger and larger periods, we would find again the same number appearing, 4.669. So that's where things started to get really weird. That we're seeing the same number appearing in very different equations. So that tells us at some level the equations or the details of the equations don't matter. There's some broader or overarching feature of these systems that's independent of the particular equation that we use. So that's something deep and something pretty surprising, I think. Let me mention just a tiny bit about the history of this idea and this realization. The results I presented date from 1978. They're usually attributed to Mitchell Feigenbaum, an American physicist, who discovered this property and then did some analytical work to try to understand it further. But it was also discovered independently by Charles Tresser and Pierre Coulet around the same time, also published in 1978. So this is a relatively new result. Another thing I want to mention is that I presented these results experimentally, the result of doing some numerical work on a computer. But there's a lot of very elegant and very powerful analytic work that calculates these numbers 4.669201 and explains why this number appears again and again. The mathematical framework for carrying out that analysis is known as a renormalization group, or just renormalization, and I'll say a little bit about that in a subsequent subunit. I can't explain it in detail, it's just too much math for the level of this course, but I can maybe give some sort of an argument for that. But before I do that, I want to mention the next thing, which is that this result is not just mathematics. So it's an amazing mathematical result. These one-dimensional functions have these beautiful bifurcation diagrams with the same branching or same sort of fork ratio in them. But this is physics as well. Period doubling occurs in real physical systems, and one can go out and measure the rates at which those period doubles, those period doublings occur, and one finds again this number 4.669. So I'll describe that result in the next lecture.